senior dietitian from the Department of Nutrition and Dietetics at TTSH, will now share with us on how taking charge of your diet to deal with chronic diseases. Ms. Yulanda, please.
Hi, morning everyone. So hope you all have had a good morning. All right. So just some short sharing before you actually go for lunch today. All right. So the topic of today's talk, all right, is take charge of your diet to deal with chronic diseases. Okay. So these are the things that I'll go through today. So just some of the background information of, you know, the prevalence of the disease, and also going through the journey. Okay. We talk about, you know, what are the things that people may encounter. Okay. When they need to deal with chronic diseases, then I'll actually do a short cooking demo. All right. And some rule of thumb, healthy eating principle, and conclusion. So I will answer question at the end of the session. Is that okay? Right. Okay. All right. So okay, I'm not going this into very detail, you know, about statistics. But the reason why I want to show this is to show the prevalence of chronic diseases in adult age 18 to 69 years old. Okay. So as you can see, right, the latest result here. Okay, in 2010. Okay. So just about hypertension, right? So actually, one out of four, okay, adult, okay, who age 18 to 69, they actually they will have the person has a hypertension. So for diabetes, it's actually 1 in 6. Okay, so for high cholesterol, it's actually 1 in 9. Okay, so the reason I want to show this is because actually what we know is chronic diseases are very prevalent. All right, so in adult. Okay, but then even though it's very prevalent, right, actually there are ways for us to manage that. So it's actually not the end of the world, okay? So now we actually talk about, you know, things that people may face when they go through the journey. Okay. Do you know the difference between acute condition and chronic condition? Do you know the difference? If before I show this. Okay, so what's the definition? So acute, you know, the meaning by itself is fast, right? Okay, chronic is actually long term. But then if you look at different aspects, so for the acute, the beginning, so as I mentioned just now, actually the onset is very fast. Okay, so for chronic, actually it's a gradual. So for example, you know, kidney disease, so it's actually it's a long-term thing. Rather than just out sudden, then you have kidney disease. So if let's say it's kind of out sudden, that the kind of kidney disease, it can be reversed, you know, it's reversible. Okay, so what we are talking today is more for the chronic side. For the cause, for acute usually is one, for chronic usually is many, all right? Then for duration, short versus indefinite, okay? Because for chronic disease, right, the truth is it's not reversible, but what is fortunate is it can be managed, even though it's not curable. So for the treatment, acute is cure, but chronic is not cure, but it can be managed. So the role of professional is for acute condition, right? So for example, imagine a person coming to hospital with acute condition like critical care, right? Critical illnesses, they will just go to the intensive ward. Then normally the doctor, they will just select the therapy, then just treat straight away, okay? Because that's an emergency situation, they have to treat it very fast. But for chronic, okay, so it's actually more on a partnership. So the role of professional, they actually partner with the family and also with the patient. So it's more on a coaching role rather than, okay, I tell you, you need to do this, then you do this. It's no, it's actually more for discussion, right? So for role of patient, so acute, no choice, because it's really the emergency situation. We really had to attend to that immediately. So that's why most of the time you have to follow the orders, okay? Right. So for the chronic, so it's actually a partner, it's daily manager. So actually because the patient or family, they're actually the one that actually face that condition practically is really every day. So that's why they are considered as a daily manager. So a lot of time, right, actually the patient or the family, right, the caregiver, right, they can actually, in fact, they can tell the healthcare professional to tell us that actually, right, you know, when I manage myself in this way, actually I have better outcome. They can really share with us. They can say, oh, you know, when I eat this, then actually my sugar level shoot up. Okay, when I eat that, then actually my sugar level is better managed. In fact, they can tell us this. Yeah, so actually this is very helpful. And also, they know, you know, why is the best time, you know, to take the food and also to take the medicine. They'll tell you, oh, if I take this medicine, then how would this affect my condition? For example, my blood pressure, my diabetes. So all these things, actually, they can tell because they're the one that manage their condition on a daily basis. Okay, unlike, you know, because chronic disease is normally the fallout, you know, at the hospital site is actually every 3 to 4 months. Okay, instead of like, you know, every day the professional check on you, unlike the acute condition, because patient is still in the hospital, in the ward. So that's why professional can do that kind of daily monitoring. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, so it's pretty straightforward. All right, so this is a cycle that I want to show you. So actually, some of the things that, you know, people may face when they have chronic disease, okay? Right, so it's actually more from the patient perspective, like I would say. Okay, so probably we look at this, okay? Start from here, pain, okay? So imagine, you know, someone who is actually overweight or obesity, right? Okay, the person may suffer from knee pain, okay? So this is where the person get the pain. When a person get a pain, right, okay, so do you think the person can still move as much as before? Probably not, right? Yeah. So this will actually affect on the activity, okay, reduce mobility, right? Okay, because of the reduction in the activity, right, so the person may become, will be deconditioned, okay? So the functional, the physical part, you know, is not as good as before already, okay? So how come fatigue come into place? Okay, it's because, right, you know, when the person decrease in strength and also decondition, okay, if the person still want to carry out the activity as before, the person has to use probably twice or three times of effort, okay, compared to usual. So this is how fatigue kick in. Okay, and also because it's a long-term condition, the person will feel very tired, you know, how come I need to deal with this, you know, every day. All right, so it's actually a lot of, you know, negative emotion here, I would say, okay? So same for this one, okay? Because of this fatigue, then the person will be very frustrated, you know, how come I'm like this, okay? So this is all the negative emotion, all right? Because of this negative emotion, right, then the person may be, you know, stressed because they may afraid that they will increase the burden of the family, okay? So they become stressed, you know, financially as well. So this is where people get stressed. Okay, when people get stressed, muscle tend to tense up, okay? When muscle tense up, okay, isn't that this will worsen the pain? Correct, right? So, you know, it's really like a vicious cycle. Yeah. So do you think, right, you know, for someone who needs to manage the condition, do you think it's helpful if the person really keep, you know, running around this circle? Do you think it's helpful? No, right? Yeah. Obviously it's not, okay. No one will say yes, right? No one, okay. So it's no, okay. So that's why we need to really have a break. So how to break this cycle? Okay. So initiative. Okay. So if a person want to improve on condition, right? Okay. So it's really taking the initiative to say that, yes, I want to have a change. Okay. So this is what we call initiative. So the ability to propel life forward in purposeful direction. Okay. Need to be more active rather than passive. Okay, and also nowadays, right, there are actually a lot of evidence to show that a patient who is actually more engaged and informed, okay, will achieve the better outcome, okay, right? So because they are more confident in managing their own condition and they are actually prepared, you know, to discuss, you know, their condition and also the treatment plan with the healthcare professional, okay? So again, what things that, you know, research has found is actually if we use an active approach versus a passive approach, right? So the active approach actually will have a better outcome. Okay, so what is self-management? Okay, so I would say it's quite self-explanatory, okay, by the word self-management. So it's really to understand on condition. Okay, so I'm not too sure, you know, whether you all encounter anyone, you know, who is diagnosed with something, right? But they actually don't know much about the on condition. Yeah, have you all come across anyone like this? Okay, so why the emphasis of understanding on condition is so important is because if you understand on condition, right, you actually know what kind of consequences, okay, will arise if, let's say, that condition is not controlled well. So understanding on condition is very important. And also, if you understand that condition, you will be able to understand how come medication is important in that treatment, okay, in the treatment plan. right? And also, a lot of time that, you know, we tend to hear is, you know, a patient take the medicine, they ask, oh, so do you take this medicine, do you take that medicine? Then the reply sometimes was, okay, so I don't know, I just take, you know, people give me that, I take. Yeah, okay, so people give me a take. So then, in a way that, you know, will be difficult, okay, I think on the patient and family side, as well as the healthcare professional side, is because we really want to know what is the result, you know, what is the outcome of you taking that medication, okay, and how does that medication affect the body. Right, and also patient, them themselves also need to know. Okay, so especially, you know, for example, on diabetes medicine, if people take already, then how would this affect the sugar level? Would it, you know, make the sugar level become better, or the sugar level still high, or the sugar level is too low? Okay, those are the things that we have to understand. All right, okay. So of course, you know, this will involve a lot of lifestyle changes, okay? So healthy eating, of course, you know, if want to break the cycle, okay, eating is actually one of the important parts as well, besides medication, okay? These two things come hand in hand. Coping with stress, okay? So if someone is too stressed, right, you know, they won't even, you know, the priority in life is not about, you know, eating healthily already, okay? It's not about, you know, I need to take medicine. They just need to cope with the emotion part rather than follow all the treatment plan, okay? So coping with stress, so actually, I'll say there's actually a lot of help up there, okay? Out there to actually seek for help. So for example, a medical social worker or, you know, a psychologist, anyone that you can talk to. Or, you know, it can be a non-healthcare professional staff, you know, it can be a close family, close friend. So those are ways that can manage the stress. Okay, be physically active. Okay, so actually, right, you know, for a person, you know, if do more exercise, be physically active, right, actually it's more cheerful, because of the endorphin also, okay, can, and also because in the previous slide, as I mentioned, as I showed just now, right, for someone who is not that active, okay, will become deconditioned. Okay, then a lot of other negative emotion will come at the same time. Okay, so improving work. Okay, so you know, for people, you know, who is actually still mobile, right? Okay, so does it mean that, you know, the person, as long as the person with chronic diseases cannot work at all? Okay, it doesn't mean that Okay, so actually for people actually with some condition, they can still work. Okay, but of course, you know, sometimes some work adjustment is required. Right, and also working can actually tend to see more people, to meet more people. That's more for the social part, social interaction. All right, so of course, changing the interaction with healthcare professional. Right, so then you actually have to think about, so what kind of treatment do you want? Do you want just to take order? Okay, you tell me what I do, then I follow. Or you want to seek for advice, you can just counter-propose. Okay, so actually I feel, you know, this treatment probably is better for me. Do you think is that? So, yeah, so you can actually check with the healthcare professional. So it's more on a discussion rather than, you know, okay, you tell me what to do, then I do. Okay, or I rather don't do if things that you tell me I don't like. Okay, it's more on a discussion part. Of course, self-monitoring. Okay, so looking at some of the chronic diseases, right, so for example, diabetes. Okay, do you think self-monitoring can be done at home? Yes, what kind of self-monitoring? The checking the sugar, right? Okay, rather than every 3 months go to the doctor to draw the blood here. So actually for diabetes, in fact, you can actually do the self-monitoring at home already. Okay, do you think blood pressure can be self-monitored? Yes, right? Okay, just buy the machine and monitor. Okay, how about cholesterol? Do you think you can self-monitor? No, right? Yeah, okay. So for cholesterol, actually, there's no way that we can do the self-monitoring. So for the blood test, so you can only go to the doctor, so every 3 to 6 months to do the monitoring. But what you can monitor is the type of food that you're eating. So this is considered one of the self-monitoring ways, okay, rather than, you know, the sugar level or the blood pressure. Okay, so the other example of self-monitoring will be, so for example, someone who wants to manage the weight, okay, so this is how we can actually do the self-monitoring. All right, can, so far so good. Can, Okay, so as I mentioned just now, right, we had to break the cycle. Okay, how about, you know, if let's say we come across someone who is actually not motivated, the person say, okay, whatever, you know, I will just continue whatever I'm doing now. Okay, how do you think you can actually help the person to make changes? Or you think, okay, we just give up on the person, you know, let the person be? Okay, so these are some of the things that you can consider. Okay, it's actually it's a powerful thing, like I would say. Okay, but of course it will take time. Of course, you know, for someone who is not keen to make any changes, you have to see, you know, you can actually have some talk with the person. Okay, what's the motivation in life? Okay, is someone, you know, okay, so want to see the grandchildren to grow up, you know, want to see grandchildren to get married. Okay, yes, this is the motivator already. Okay, so. Okay, so and if let's say the person want to see a grandchildren to get married, right? Okay, so what you can ask the person is, okay, so how would you like things to change? Okay, so if you want to see grandchildren married, but if your diabetes is not well controlled, okay, so how do you think you can help yourself, you know, for you to sustain that long in order to see your grandchildren to get married? Okay, so those are the questions that you can ask. Okay, so but of course, asking is actually in a nicer way, not an intimidating way, lah. Okay, otherwise you have a lot of argument also. Okay, alright. So ability, so what do you think you might be able to change? Okay, so because, you know, for someone that want to commit to a certain changes, right, okay, so we also need to be realistic, okay, so that's why to check with the person, what does the person think probably would be the possible things that the person can make changes, rather than, you know, just everything, you know, everything on the list, then just do everything, because it's not realistic. Too much at one time already, okay? So reason, so, okay, so let's say the person say, I want to make these changes. You can ask the person, okay, so how come, you know, you select this and you want to focus on this? Why do you want to change this? Okay, is to help the person to think, okay, so what are the benefits of making these changes? Okay, so need, what needs to happen? Okay, so if you want to, for example, if a person want, say, I want to reduce sugar intake. Okay, so, you can ask the person, oh, so then now you say you want to reduce sugar intake, so what do you need to do? Okay, so you are talking about the action plan already, so you are actually more specific rather than something that is very general kind of statement to say, I want to reduce sugar intake, that's all. But you really need to go into detail. Okay, yes, I want to reduce sugar intake, okay? So from now onwards, from tomorrow onwards, right, you know, my tea, instead of putting 1 teaspoon of sugar, okay, from tomorrow onwards, I put 1/2 teaspoon. Okay, is this kind of approach, all right? Okay, so commitment. So what do you think you will do? So you actually get the person to verbalize. Okay, so yes, I want to reduce sugar, so I'll reduce from 1 teaspoon to 1/2 teaspoon. Okay, so this is about the creating the change talk. Okay, so in summary, right, it's actually the goal. So actually, these are the steps now. So goal setting, so identify things that want to make changes first. Right, okay, so talk about how can we make the changes, okay, and also what are the specific things that we want to make changes, and action plan, and also for how long. So, for example, I want to achieve this by when and when, okay, I want to reduce my sugar intake, okay, so I'll give myself a 2-week time, okay, so 2-week time, okay, I'll review this again to see, okay, so how's my progress, so have I making any changes? Okay, so let's say, you know, but actually, right, making changes, I would say, of course, people will face challenges, okay, because the reason why people still continue the previous eating habit is because that's really already a habit, all right? So for a person to actually have a new habit to kick in, right, actually it takes time. So that's why, okay, track the changes and also review, you know, what are the issues that the person faces is very important, okay? Then, if let's say we check the issue already, right? Okay, so we may go back here again, okay, to reset the goal, okay? Because probably, you know, the previous goal, okay, that's not realistic, okay? So those are the things, these are the steps, okay, in making changes and setting goals. Okay, so this is the example, all right? So, okay, so I'm going to target on the salt intake part, okay? Because as I mentioned earlier on, right, so actually the prevalence of hypertension, okay, is 1 in 4 adult, okay? So imagine, you know, someone actually always eat out, right? So the salt intake is about 12 grams per day. But in fact, the recommendation is 5 grams per day. Okay? So it's actually, I would say it's more than double already, right? Correct. But in order for the person to reduce from 12 grams to 5 grams, okay, so we cannot say overnight change, because the taste bud also need time to readjust the new level of the sodium, the salt level. Okay. Okay, so we can probably say, you know, every 2 weeks, okay, go, right? So every 2 weeks, so if we manage to do that, right, you see the salt intake can reduce from 12 to 9 grams, okay, just by changing one outside meal to the home prepared meal, okay, but the person still can enjoy outside food, Okay, it's more about, okay, so don't put the gravy, okay, but previously person always put gravy. All right, rather than just say, no, you cannot have outside food at all. Okay, it's not realistic, like I would say, okay? And also because most working adult for lunch, right? So no choice, you know, we have to eat out, okay? Right? Okay, how about in week 5? Okay, we can actually, in fact, reduce further, okay? So the lunch, the breakfast is still home-prepared meal. Of course, it's not always, you know, bread and egg, right? Okay, we can be more creative, okay? Right, so things we can do, we can make further changes will be the home-prepared meal. Okay, so home-prepared meal, actually, we need to focus on the amount of seasoning that we put. Okay, because sometimes home-prepared meal, it can be unhealthy as well. And let's say we use a lot of processed food, okay, a lot of seasoning. Okay, week 7. Okay, if let's say we manage to reduce outside food for lunch, okay, and use the lower sodium cooking method, then we can actually manage to reduce the salt to this much. Okay, so everything is actually in the stepwise, in the gradual manner, rather than, okay, overnight, okay, next day, I want to change. For someone actually who is actually motivated, I've seen before, they already make overnight change. Okay? But the thing is, after you make changes overnight, it will be sustainable. Alright? Okay? Can I? Okay. Any questions so far before I move on? Yes? No? Sorry? Yes? Yes, correct. Yeah? Yes, correct. Mm. So I think a lot of time, I think it depends on the focus of on the person. If let's say the focus on the person is really, you know, high salt intake. Okay, so actually at that moment, the short-term goal, I would say, is more on the, we'll target on the sodium part. Mm. Of course, you know, this, after the person make changes to this diet, it may not be the perfect yet. Okay, yeah. Then we'll actually slowly make further changes. Mm. Okay, so we won't end for perfect, you know, at one goal, I would say. Otherwise, it's not realistic. Yes, yeah, correct. Yes, okay. So for the oil part, I will cover in my later part of the session, okay?
How much is 3 grams
of salt in 12 grams? Mm, okay. Mm, okay, so 1 teaspoon is 5 grams. Yes, correct, okay? So later, I will cover the I will cover the sodium part because I'm going to show you the conversion, okay, of salt, you know, to other sodium seasoning.
Mm.
Mm. This one is more for the added seasoning because in fact, right, our natural food sources, there are salt inside already. Mm. So actually for the added seasoning, if you can use the least, the better.
Mm.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, so hopefully, hopefully I'm able to demonstrate that now. Okay, I will show you what I'm going to prepare now. Okay, so it's a chicken and veggie mixed rice. So I'm going to do in a small portion only, 2 servings. Okay, because the reason is because, you know, a lot of time, you know, feedback that I heard, you know, from patient or family is, okay, I don't cook because 1 person eat only or 2 person eat only. So that's why I don't cook. Right? So actually, that's why I have this recipe, which is meant for smaller cooking. All right. Okay, so very simple. I don't use fire. I only have the rice cooker. Right? Student, maybe come over here. Okay. I need them to help me hold the mic. Okay, so that I speak, then you all can hear. All right? Can one will do? Can thanks. Just closer. Okay. Can right. So actually, I have pre-washed everything. Right? Okay. So what I'm going to do now is okay. I will actually put in the rice. I washed the rice already, don't worry. Today I use I mix white rice with brown rice, okay? Because I'm concerned that, you know, some people may not use to just eat brown rice because the texture may be a bit too rough, okay? Yeah. Okay. So I have put the rice here, Okay. So next, I'll put water. It just, okay, I'm sure that, you know, maybe some of you, okay, actually do cooking, okay, better than me, all right? So I'm just a gentle reminder. So let's say you cook brown rice, right, actually you need to add more water, lah, okay? Let's say just white rice, if the rice, so the ratio is probably 1-1, okay? So one portion of rice, one portion of the water, okay? But let's say you cook brown rice, probably 1 to 1.5 or 2, lah, okay? But because I'm going to add other ingredients into one pot as well, I have veggie, so actually the water, you may not need as much compared to when you just cook brown rice itself, the rice itself. Yes, correct. Yes, correct. Mm. But actually for someone actually who doesn't really have extra time, right, they can also cook the rice on the same day. Like, it's just that they need more water. Okay? Yes. I do it is actually more for the convenience sake. Mm, correct. Okay. So because actually the feedback that I got from patient family is because, you know, I need to cook, I need to wash so many things, many pots, many pans, so that's why, okay, so they actually you only need one rice cooker. Mm, it's more for the convenience sake. But for people that actually want to actually steam the item or stir fry separately, yes, they can feel free to do so as well, as long as the diet is balanced. Mm. So next, what I will do is I will add the ingredient inside. Actually, the sequence doesn't matter, okay? So you can decide whether you want to put mushroom first or stone pea first or chicken first. It doesn't matter, okay? So so actually, right, yes, if you want to have the green color, right, you want to preserve the green color, you can actually put it probably about 5 minutes before it's cooked. Okay, but then actually now I put everything in is because it's really for those that people that actually don't have time to cook, okay? So when the moment they step in the home, okay, they just have to wash everything, cut, then put, okay? Then press on this one, they can then go to do other things already. It's really more for the convenience sake, okay? Can. So it's not really like those chef kind of professional cooking, lah, okay? So later I will explain the content of the rice, okay? So I have mushroom here. Of course, you can put any kind of vegetable, not just mushroom, lah, okay? So I have a stone pea here as well. So I choose mushroom and stone pea is because more for the color. Okay, so the color combination. Okay. So last thing that I'll put is actually chicken. Okay, so the chicken, right, so I remove the fat, remove the skin, I cut into a small cube. Okay, so actually I marinate with sesame oil and ginger. Okay, I mince the ginger. Okay, so I don't put other seasoning. All right. Okay, so everything is done. So I just close and press, then we continue the talk. Okay, Ken? Okay, are we ready to continue the talk? Yes, okay. I'll explain in more detail about the content of the rice, okay? So, you know, how do I decide, you know, the portion, everything, okay? Thank you. Okay, so hopefully you can smell the fragrance later, okay, when it's cooked, while we continue our talk. Okay, so this is the rice recipe. Okay, so you can actually change the ingredient here. Okay, yeah, so not to worry, you can actually choose things that you like to eat, okay? So I choose this is more for the color combination, okay? Of course, you know, chicken, you can change to fish, you can change to pork. Okay, it's up to you. But just that because pork, you know, maybe a bit too tough. Okay, so you may just want to put at the last step. Okay, not to put in so soon. Okay? Okay, so HD, right, you know, when we talk about chronic disease management, right, about eating, okay, so how do we manage the eating, right? HD, right, is not very different, you know, compared to, you know, the healthy people, okay, people without any chronic disease, okay, because everyone should follow the healthy eating principle, okay. So HBB, right, they actually have the my healthy plate, okay. So this is actually to guide people to have a balanced meal. Okay, so, but of course the cooking method, okay, must be, it's recommended to have a lower in sodium, sugar and fat. Okay, so for people, you know, with all these conditions, right, actually, this is applicable. Okay, probably it's just that for diabetes, right, something maybe a bit different will be the portion for the carbohydrate. Okay, so meaning for the rice, you know, for the noodle, for the bread, biscuit, okay, so this one is actually more individualized. Right, okay. For the kidney disease, right, probably the additional focus will be potassium, okay. So potassium meaning the type of fruits and vegetable, okay. Then the other thing will be a bit different, will be the phosphate, okay. So phosphate meaning it can be the dairy products or other processed food, okay. So which I won't go into very detail now, okay. Can, alright, so because that's more on the individualized basis lah. Alright, okay, but regardless what kind of condition a person has, right, so the person is still recommended to have a balanced diet with the healthy cooking method. So this is the main message that I want to get across. Alright? Okay, so actually, right, so the rice that I'm cooking now, so this one is to serve for 2 persons. Okay, so if if for 1 person, one serving, so what does it consist? Okay, okay. So it consists of 50% of the protein, okay, of the day already. Okay, 50% of the vegetable of the day, 30% of the carbohydrate of the day already. Okay, so actually it shows you it's a balanced diet. So let's say you eat this one bowl, okay, and also dinner, okay, you know, you have a rice meal, then with the veggie, with the meat, right? So actually this shows you are actually having a balanced diet. Okay, so rice, how come it's only 30%? Because you can't be eating 50% here, because you also need to portion some for your dinner, you also need to portion some for your breakfast. Okay, because normally breakfast, we seldom eat so much veggie as well, and also we seldom eat so much protein. Okay, so that's why this one, the food I prepare now is actually for the main meal, okay, for lunch or for dinner. Okay, and also as what you can see just now, right, actually, do I put any sugar? No, right? Okay. So do I put any salty seasoning? No, right? So I only use sesame oil and ginger to marinate. Okay. So low in fat. Okay. Okay. So I only put a little bit of sesame oil. Okay. And the amount, right? Okay. Is actually less than 1 teaspoon. Nah. Okay. And the amount of sodium here, I have calculated, right? So actually it's less than 1 gram of salt. Okay. So just like I mentioned, the recommended amount is 5 grams per day. Okay. So you're just having this one bowl of rice, which is a complete meal, okay, it only give you less than 1 gram. So actually, if let's say you can switch one of the outside food with this, actually this will help to reduce the salt intake a lot. Because normally the outside food, one portion, okay, is actually at least 4 to 5 grams of salt. Okay, so you can see, hope you can see the difference. All right. Okay, and just now, okay, this lady mentioned, yes, we can use a lot of natural ingredients. Yes, it is, okay, can. So those are the things that we can use. All right. Okay, and this is a seasoning as change list that I mentioned just now. Okay, so 1 gram of the salt, okay, is equal to 1 teaspoon of the soy sauce. Okay, if you want to take picture, yes, you can feel free to do so. Okay, because a lot of time we don't just use salt in cooking. Actually, we use other seasoning. Okay. Okay, and also different type of fat. Okay, so actually saturated fat is actually the bad fat. It will actually affect the bad cholesterol. It's the LDL cholesterol. So these are the sources of the saturated fat. So many is from the animal source. Okay. Right, so trans fat, okay. So we tend to get this from the deep fried food, okay. And also some of the pastry, okay, because it's present in the vegetable shortening. Monounsaturated fat, this is a good fat. It will actually help to manage the cholesterol, okay. So it will actually lower the bad cholesterol. So these are the sources. And this is polyunsaturated fat, okay. So you can actually get from fish, okay, oily fish, and you can get from these healthy oil and seeds. All right. Can I? Okay, so cholesterol, okay. So to manage the blood cholesterol level, of course, you know, not just focus on the trans fat, the saturated fat, the cholesterol intake is something that we need to focus as well. Okay, so these are the food sources. Of course, the recommendation is to choose things from here rather than things from here. Okay, even though I have stated, you know, the amount of the cholesterol here, like 300 milligram, but it's actually not to ask you to go and calculate how much you are actually taking in one day, because it will be too, I would say, technical already. It's not realistic, right? Okay, so just focus on the food sources will do. Okay, so the conclusion, right, is actually a person who is actually more engaged in the personal care, right, okay, making decision, actually have the better outcome. All right, and also it's always not too late to make any changes. Okay, even a small change compared to no change at all, it's already a good change. Okay, and also if you have any concern, you can discuss with your dietitian or you can discuss with your doctors. All right, okay, so one last thing. So knowing is not enough, we must really do. Okay, and also willing is not enough, we also must really do. Okay, so this is my sharing session, right? So now it's a Q&A. Okay, so do you have any question? Yes. Okay, sure. No issue. Can. You can take photo. Yes.
Is it scientific proven that fasting is good for health?
Fasting is good. Okay.
Very tight to it.
Okay. Actually, right, you know. Okay, so because just now, okay, so the example they quoted for the Muslim side, I would say that one is actually more on the religion part lah. Okay, so probably I talk about the non-religion part. Okay, not for religious reason. Okay, so actually there's no evidence to show that fasting can actually remove the toxic lah. It's not there's no way that we can actually prove that it's actually good for detox. But actually, and also fasting, right, we also need to take note lah. So because actually fasting, things that people may compromise is really the nutrition part, okay? And also for people with chronic condition, they also need to take note of, how does the medication affect, the body when they are fasted. Yes? Okay, so maybe you want to share your experience?
I've seen a lady who had a stroke. She was never sent to the hospital.
Oh, okay.
There was fasting for 21 days, drink water, plus other things. He had a stroke on the Chinese New Year. 2 months later, he's able to walk and talk and share his
experience. I see.
Yeah.
So,
there's no intervention.
Okay. I think right. So I think this kind is a rare case. I would say right. But because what we know in a scientific paper is there's no research to conduct in this area. But let's say it's really something. It's a real case. And it's worth for sharing. Right. I think it's actually something that we can make known to others. Okay. But of course, we also need to assess the person condition. Because the stroke, it can be the major. It can be the minor. So actually, the treatment plan, the intervention can be quite different. Yes.
The book, some say yes, some say bad for her. What you should do to stop and fall the cold. After then, water will come. You say that you must boil water, boil, because she will take from this. For my knowledge, it depends what the technique is. You may eat a healthy diet. Then, what's the bad for her? I read one book, it says that if you talk, you go to the human digestion, become animal fat. If you eat cow goat, through the digestion, become human fat. Only pork become animal fat.
Okay. So in fact, right, actually any kind of the animal meat, so animal meat meaning, can be pork, can be chicken, can be duck. Fish, right, is also considered animal source, okay? So of course, the fat content, if you compare to veggie, the fat content of course will be higher, okay? And also, right, if the cooking method is high in oil and also excessive eating in portion, right, everything will also convert into fat in the body. Yeah, but whether you know pork, you know, whether you know fish is superior than pork, or pork is actually not as good as other meat type, right? I would say not so lah. Okay, it really depends on the method they prepare, and also if pork if it's a fatty pork versus a lean pork, of course you know the lean pork is better. But whether or not you know it's hygienic enough, whether it got any germs, right? I would say right, it really depends on the storage. Okay, of course you know it depends on the how does the factory actually slaughter the pig. Mm. But I'll say because in Singapore, right, actually AVA, they do the random check also lah. So actually, I think we must be confident, you know, with their checking also. Mm. Yes. This one? Ah, okay, yes, you can take photo. Yes.
I understand that everybody body inside because lack of sugar, too much of salt,
maybe. Mm-hmm. Mm, okay, so actually, okay, probably, okay, so I target on the sugar part first, okay? So actually, right, for sugar, not to worry, like, because if let's say for someone who is still eating bread or biscuit, you know, or noodles or bihun, actually, this is a form of sugar already. So when it gets digested in the body, it will become glucose. And glucose is something that is required by our muscle, required by our brain. It doesn't mean that, you know, for someone, actually, they need to purposely go and eat one teaspoon of sugar. Mm, it doesn't work that way. Mm. In fact, actually, that you know, additional sugar we add in our diet, right? That's considered extra. It doesn't give any nutrient besides calorie.
If you diabetes is 6.5 or 7, right?
You're talking about daily check, is it?
Yeah, for diabetes.
Okay.
Including now my level is about 6.5 or about 6.8.
You're talking about HbA1c or daily check?
Myself. So I checked last month.
Oh, so it's HbA1c.
The doctor tell me that control my sugar. So
Are you still on the diabetes medication?
No.
Not at all?
No.
So means you're actually not on any diabetes medication at all. Okay, so just on the diet control. Okay, so I think first thing is what I would suggest is, of course, you know, I can't do the individualized advice now. So what I would suggest is, it's also looking at the quantity of the food. Whether the intake is adequate or not for the whole day, okay? But it doesn't mean that, you know, someone has to purposely go and take sugar. And the other thing about giddiness, right, actually, blood pressure is something they have to take note as well, okay? Because giddiness, it can be contributed by many, many reasons, not just sugar itself. Mm. If, let's say, you're on diabetes medication, okay, and you cut down your food portion, and now you're telling me that you feel a bit giddy, then I'll be more concerned that, okay, probably it's because you have made good change in your diet, but your diabetes medication is not adjusted yet. So then, the next step will be probably tune down your diabetes medication and monitor your sugar level further.
Yeah, I think I'm also taking what I plan for every day, then have to eat and discipline yourself.
Oh, that's very good.
Okay. Can I think? Yeah. Okay. So, do you plan to share with anyone? You know, in the near future, about you know your. I mean, after you have success, you know, in whatever you're doing.
It's very good. You see, whatever signals you have, you find out what is actually causing your problem and what you should be doing. Then you have to set action. Then okay.
How long? I see. How long have you embarking on this journey of cell monitoring?
About half a year.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So what you can share with us now is you definitely can see the positive outcome, is it?
Everybody must. I mean, you must plan yourself, and then if you don't do that, there's no point. And you have to monitor.
Yeah. I think you can really be an advocate already. Yeah, that's very good. Mm. Yes.
How about GMO products? Is it bad for health? Because in US, it's a law, because labor is a GMO product. You eat at your own risk. But Singapore,
Okay, so
we don't know is it the product is GMO, then we eat also we risk. No, is it bad for the health? Because it's not.
Mm, okay, so probably I'll just let everyone know. So what does this gentleman mean by GMO? So it's genetically modified the product, okay? So actually, right, there's no strong evidence to say that whether it's good or not lah. It really depends on the country. And actually, in Singapore, right, actually, there's no declaration. It's not compulsory to declare that, you know, it's a GMO or it's a GMO product. Whether you know it will have a direct, you know, negative impact, okay, it's not confirmed, okay, because there's no scientific research to actually do that lah. Not enough evidence to show that. But for some people, they're actually more concerned, right? Actually, yes, they can actually avoid those items. They can find for replacement. Okay, so for example, like soy milk. Soy milk is actually the common product. People will label whether it's a GMO or not GMO. Okay, so for people that are strong advocate of, you know, yes, I don't want to take any GMO product, okay, then you just go for the non-GMO soy milk. So actually, the choice are available out there. Yes?
Company has stopped removing chicken skin. It actually good for you. So, the expert, health expert from the university or other, say that it's good for you, but moderate.
They say, when they say good for you, do they say in what sense?
They didn't say, of course, they say you didn't say moderate. They didn't mention what is good.
This is a long way.
Yeah. I would say actually, right, it's still not good. It's because of the saturated fat, okay, and also the cholesterol from the animal fat. Yeah. Sorry. Did I mention prostate care? A genetically modified product, not prostate care. You mean prostate cancer, prostate? Okay, actually there's no special diet lah. It's actually more for the healthy diet, okay? Just ensure you have enough fruits and vegetables. Okay, there's no recommended dose of, you know, if you take this dose will affect, you know, there's no recommended dose. No. But to do it coffee, right, of course it depends on the type of coffee lah. If let's say the coffee is made with full cream milk, you know, a lot of creamer, of course it's not good.
Yeah, due to time restriction, we only accommodate one more.
Yes. Sorry, take your time. Okay, it's okay. Oh, you want to ask me later also, Ken? I will be here. Okay?
Oh, I think you have to the egg yolk. The milk goes with no cereal. Milk with no yolk, right? It's a cereal, right? It's good for that.
No, full fat dairy product contains higher saturated fat. Yeah, so higher saturated fat is not good for LDL. So yes, you can still choose milk, choose a low fat or skim milk. But if for people that want to control the the sugar level, the diabetes, right, go for unflavored milk will be better. Yeah, so meaning don't go for those chocolate milk, don't go for those strawberry milk. So just go for the plain, okay, low fat and skim milk. Okay.
So people who look like sweet tooth, they say it's okay to take a little ice cream. Or is it okay with diabetic patients?
Okay, so of course, you know, if let's say the daily control is actually very good, right? Okay, sometimes, yes, can reward ourselves lah. Because again, it's a... sometimes meaning it's not on the daily basis lah, you know? Okay, it can be like 1 month, one time, okay, provided the daily control is actually very good. It's because actually, it's as I mentioned, right, it's actually a long-term disease, okay? Something, we only need to balance the quality of life versus the health outcome, okay? So let's say for people that we are always very, very strict, okay, actually, and now they don't have quality of life, is it something that the person will enjoy doing? It's actually more on this balance, actually, and always, this is the challenge that people always face, okay? It's not just like one-off that, okay, you settle this issue, next time you won't face, okay? Maybe next, a few months later, people may have same issue again, so we have to revisit this issue again and talk about this. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Ken, thank you.